Another one?
Yeah.
Another one?
No.
Just another one?
Consonant. Consonant. Vowel. Three from the top, Carol. Isn't that fun? Have you seen my knees before?
I was trying not to look.
Oh, don't be silly. But I'm wondering, have you ever seen my knees?
No, you haven't got much hair on your leg, Gyles.
No, it's because I wax my knees.
You wax your knees? That's like back, sack and crack and knees, is that right?
I've heard that expression.
Yeah.
But, well, let's not go into it. Back, sack and
back,
crack.
Back, sack and crack and knees.
Is that what people have when they have a...
Apparently.
Are you into all that?
What? I don't...
Milk? Milk?
I don't have a sack, Gyles.
Gyles, after watching that, I have mental images I really did not want on a Saturday morning.
Oh, my gosh. Thank goodness my wife was away staying with her sister.
I'm sure she would have been thrilled with you.
She would have been, she was appalled to see it and see me in my shorts. She said, I haven't seen you. Of course, my wife hasn't really seen me, hasn't seen my knees in many years because, very sensibly, she turns out the light before getting into bed.
Oh,
so there's, you know, oh, deary me.
You do have a lovely tan, though.
Thank you very much indeed. I spend a lot of time out of doors, and I like that, and I walk everywhere. This is a week for me of anniversaries, because it is literally 50 years ago this week that I first wore a novelty jumper, sweater. And I'm wearing one of my favourites for you today, my snake. I designed this myself. But 50 years ago, I presided over the second National Scrabble Championships here in England. I founded it 51 years ago, and somebody brought to this competition a sweater, a jumper, of a Scrabble board, saying Gyles Brandreth loves Scrabble, the word game Scrabble. And that's how it began. So this is an anniversary for me. 50 years ago, this week, was my first jumper. And as my wife says to me, Gyles, there's been no career progress. There's been no development.
Well, I wouldn't say that. You're on with us now. I mean, this has to be a career highlight.
I suppose it is, actually. Yeah. I peaked now. Today's my peak. Well done, both of you, being here on a Saturday morning when you should be out doing the weekly shop.
You're clearly delighted, though, to be back on the sofa in terms of Gogglebox, because you, like the rest of us, you love your television. You know what you like and you know what you don't like, but also to be back working with Carol.
Well, I'm discovering things I didn't know that I liked. I mean, when I began doing this, the first series I did was with the great Sheila Hancock, a wonderful actress, now in her 90th year.
Wow.
And, and she was wonderful. But it was a bit strange because it was, I think, during the first lockdown. And we were sitting there in our bubble on a sofa, the pair of us, me, yes, there is Sheila. Isn't she glamorous? Extraordinary. 90 this year. Fantastic. So feisty, so full of fun. And our eyes popped open as we found ourselves getting hooked on something called naked attraction.
I saw this. It was hilarious. She was horrified.
Well, she was horrified and slightly bemused, and as was I. I mean, it's a bit early in the day to be sharing this with you, but I suddenly found this lady, as I say, nearing her 90th year, trying to explain to me what a fanny flutter is. You know, I'd heard of Fanny Craddock, but I thought we're going too far here. Anyway, so that was
difference.
An exhilarating start. And then I did it with Maureen Lipman. And both of them, immediately after they'd done Gogglebox with me, were made dames. Not before, but after. And I think this is because the Queen must be watching Gogglebox. She thought, these women have suffered enough sitting on a sofa in this time. We must give them something to boost their morale. So then they came up with the idea of pairing me with another very old friend of mine who I did actually first meet more than 50 years ago, the beautiful Joanna Lumley. So I had Dame Sheila, then Dame Noreen, and then Dame Joanna wearing, I see, one of my lovely jumpers, the Taurus jumper.
Wow.
And then Joanna went off to do some work, and they said, well, tell me another friend you'd like to have over. It's got to be a genuine friend. That's the joy.
Yeah.
The joy of Gogglebox is it's for real. It's really in your home. The cameras are hidden. Then the people making the program are not in the building with you. It's done remotely. You genuinely are there watching the shows. And you're doing it with a very old friend. In the case of Carol Vorderman, I met her when she was 21, doing Countdown, which began 40 years ago this year. And I said to her when she was 21, this is no job for an intelligent woman. Get out. No, seriously, get out of television as quickly as you can. But there's no future for you in this.
It's lovely to see the A-team back, the Countdown A-team back again, because I loved watching you both on it, and Cara was absolutely amazing. So you have that longevity of your mutual careers and you're back together, just having the crack, literally, as you were talking about in that clip that we saw.
Well, I mean, which of us is which there? It's hard to tell. She's the one on the right, and I'm the first bloke in. That's me, one of my jobs. Oh, I hope my wife isn't watching, because she's got Irish family. She could be in Cork this weekend. I never know where she is.
I'm from Cork.
She could be watching. Are you from Cork?
I am.
I was going to say my wife's grandmother was a nun, but that doesn't sound quite right. I think her auntie was a nun. Anyway, they were a lovely, good Cork family. And Cork is beautiful.
It is a gorgeous place.
I'm the president of the Oscar Wilde Society here in the UK.
Right.
And we do occasionally make pilgrimages to Dublin.
You, of course, must know Senator David Norris then, or gorgeous senator over here. A Joycean. Oh, sorry, he's Joycean. Sorry, he's not Oscar Wilde.
He's not Joycean. Well,
Sligo is Oscar Wilde, isn't it? Sligo country.
It's the same. It's the same.
That's
sort of thing.
I'm getting all confused.
Oh, my goodness, yes. Oh, you've at least got the right people. There's George Bernard Shaw. There's quite a few of
with
them.
Beckett in there as well.
We're spoiled for a choice.
Beckett. But we won't go into the fact that so many of them seem to leave Ireland. I mean, Beckett ended up in Paris, didn't he?
Wrote
most of his stuff in French and then translated it back into English. Anyway, we love Oscar Wilde. And the great thing about these wonderful Irish writers is they become universal.
Yeah.
And there is a kind of... And that's the glory, for me, of Dublin, is that it is a world city. And its sons and daughters, they began in Dublin... But their words and their works, frankly, have conquered the world.
Couldn't have put it better myself, Gyles. Can I ask you, Gyles, what you seem to, no matter what, anytime that we see you on TV, be it on This Morning or on Countdown or on Gogglebox, you always seem to have a smile on your face. Do you put that down, your longevity as a career, you know, with your career on TV, do you have to enjoy it, Gyles?
Drugs. That's the answer. I'm on drugs.
Heavy medication.
That's a little joke. I'm not at all. I've even forgotten to take my statins, which is a bad thing.
Oh, dear.
So, I have to be honest with you. I mean, you know, you have a choice in life. For everybody, the glass is half full or half empty. And I choose to see it as half full. It's a very grim world if you stop to think about it. So I try not to stop to think about it most of the time. When I was a little boy, I'd forgotten this. I wrote a memoir about my childhood during lockdown called Odd Boy Out. And I kept a diary from the age of 10. And in 1959, I went to a new school. I was sent to a boarding school. My parents sent me, I thought because they didn't like me. That's why they sent me. But it turned out not to be that cat. They sent me to boarding school because I wouldn't stop talking, apparently, at home. And my sisters got together with my parents and said, look, he talks, it's insufferable. He won't stop talking. And my sisters pooled their pocket money, gave their pocket money to my parents to contribute to the school. So I was sent away to a boarding school, and I was very small, because I wouldn't stop talking at home. And at this boarding school, I met the old headmaster, a lovely man called Mr. Stocks, who said to me when I was 9 or 10, Brandreth, remember, busy people are happy people. Remember that. And I've remembered that from 1959 to this day. And that's why I've kept busy, because I've found over the years that it's true. On the whole, busy people are happy people. My wife would say, busy fool you. But I say, actually, busy people are happy people.
I think you...
It was at that school, too. Have I got time to share this with
you? Yes, go for it.
That I met for the first time one of my favourite actors, Roger Moore.
Wow.
Remember Roger Moore? Yes. Sir Roger Moore, 007, James Bond.
My favourite Bond.
The humorous James Bond, and he was. Yeah. He's so stylish. And I met him because another of our teachers, Major Douch, who taught us Latin, didn't teach us very well Latin. For many years, I thought in loco parentis meant my dad's an engine driver. Anyway, Major Douch had a best friend from the army. And his best friend from the army was the young Roger Moore, who was already a bit of a star in those days, appearing in a TV series called The Saint. And so Roger Moore came to the school at weekends to visit his friend Major Douch. And we schoolboys got to know this amazing, incredibly good-looking young actor. And I stayed in touch with Roger Moore all my life.
Wow.
And eventually Roger Moore discovered I wanted to be an actor. And I said to him, you know, I've read you, Roger, saying that whenever you get a part in a film and the director calls you, you tell the director, you've only got two looks to offer the camera. It's either left eyebrow or right eyebrow. That's what you say. That's all you could do. Left eyebrow or right. I said, if it's that easy, Roger, will you teach me? And he gave it a go. He gave it a go, but he didn't succeed. And so I said to him, why? I've got the left eyebrow. I can't get the right eyebrow. He said, it's very simple, Gyles. Yeah. It seems you're half the actor I am.
I love it.
Unsurprisingly, Gyles once held the record for the longest after-dinner speech at 12 and a half hours. But unfortunately, we've run out of time and can't go into that much more.
Gyles, it's been a joy catching up with you. We hope to see you in person soon. Come on over to Ireland. We'd love to see you.
I look forward to it. And come and sit on my sofa with me. Not, you know, who knows what the future holds.
I'll trade you in, Simon. I'd be only delighted.